This time, Dolores Phillips, our legislative director of that project, was in Trenton for three different committee meetings, organized people to testify. By the way, each time we testified, there were three NRA people testifying against, so that's just, doesn't matter how common sense it is, they're always going to be on the other side. But we overcame it. It was a bipartisan, unanimous vote in both houses of the legislature, and Governor Christie signed it on his last full day as governor, January 15th. So I think that is a big bipartisan success. I want to salute Moms Demand Action for the, also for their bipartisan approach. I think that's the strongest result. I'm not as ready to give up on an assault weapons ban as Meghan was. It would be a heavy lift, but we've done it before. Yeah. We had a national ban from 1994 to 2004. And actually, there is at least one study. The Brady campaign did a study that showed that there was a dramatic reduction in the number of people killed by assault weapons, which would make sense, because if they're harder to get, you're going to be less likely to use them in mass shootings. So these are the weapon of choice of these mass shooters. If we want to reduce mass shootings, it seems to me, they were designed for the battlefield. These are battlefield weapons. And that's one reason we started to get involved in gun violence prevention. We said if we're against weapons trafficking abroad, we ought to be against it on our own streets too. Weapons of war don't belong on the streets of America. New Jersey has its assault weapons ban still in place. We defeated an effort by the NRA in 1993 to rescind it. And so I think there are signs of hope, and we shouldn't give up entirely. I think it is not on the near-term agenda, but I think on a medium-term agenda, it would be something that would reduce the risk quite considerably of these mass shootings, combined with a national bump stock ban. In fact, one of the things I did when I got the good news, that was also Martin Luther King's birthday, of course, January 15th, so I'm glad the governor did decide, Governor Christie I'm talking about, to sign, is I immediately got out a press release saying New Jersey is leading the way, and we showed how it can be done on a bipartisan basis. Why won't we get the U.S. Congress to get its act together and do it too?
Reed, are you there? Well, that's all the questions I have. Is there anyone else that would like to?
Could I just add something? I have a discussion. I've looked at the material of the media.
You can stand up there.
Stand up. I work as a Syrian refugee camp in Greece last summer, and most of the Syrians that I'm speaking to, which I spoke to, all suffering from PTSD. And a lot of it was from drones, not necessarily because they didn't attack by drones, but if you have a drone circling your village for 4 hours, with the chance that it may well launch out of us, it's very, very expensive. And it's significant that the kids I work with, any aircraft, any fuel came over the grounds of the bushes again. And as Bob Smith knows, I'm very much into the drone scene of war, or the adventure, once a month, as Bob Smith said. But the blowback against this country of hatred is developing. It's just something that so many people don't appreciate. It's not an industry, it's not an industry. We're going to have more and more terrorist attacks. And it's only a question of time before other countries have mechanized drones.
Right.
There are lots of countries that have drones. They're very cheap. And we're going to have attacks against American interests abroad, US embassies. And who knows what you have in this country. There's not a drone flag on some planet. The drones have been put on destroyers. And the country of these wouldn't destroy them.
One thing on that?
Sure. Go ahead.
Yeah. So I actually, that reminded me of something I forgot to mention, and when drones had come up before, which is that the idea that U.S. troops aren't somehow being hurt by being operators of these drones, actually, I think is incorrect. I think it's wrong-headed. What we're finding is that the rate of PTSD among the drone operators is actually higher than it is for people deployed on the ground in war zones. And think about this. Part of it is because when you're a drone operator, it's true you're thousands of miles away from where the actual killing is being done, but you're seeing it up very close because the surveillance drones are watching. And you actually see the body parts getting blown apart. You see it all up close, and it's like you're exposed to some very gruesome truths when you are a drone operator. And so they're actually having trouble having enough drone operators because the rate of dropout is so high. They get PTSD and can't continue it. A number of drone operators have become whistleblowers, which I'm very grateful for that. That's a very proud tradition to blow the whistle against excessive militarism, and I'm afraid we have a crisis of militarism in this country once again. That's, I think, a very good development that it actually is therapeutic in some ways for some of these drone operators to come and speak out against what they used to do. We saw that with Vietnam veterans against the war, Iraq veterans against the war. A lot of people who have seen war up close and see all of the deceptions, we always need to be cautious of wars of mass deception, you know, because they can lead to wars of mass destruction. And so the American people got duped into the Iraq war under false circumstances. By the way, I can share one personal story since we're running a little ahead of time. Hans Blix was the chief weapons inspector in Iraq before the Iraq war. He went and I talked to him in person. He was speaking for us some years ago, and he said he went to the White House and spoke to President Bush and gave him an in-person briefing to say, I can vouch for the fact that that Iraq has no nuclear weapons. He said, give me two more months and my inspectors will be able to verify that it also has no chemical or biological weapons. Those were the main factors that were used to justify going in for the Iraq war. And President Bush said, no, I'm ready to go in and I'm going. And so for two months, I mean, I think there actually is a connection between patience and peacemaking. You know, people who are sort of trigger happy and wait, just sort of eager to go to war, many of them who haven't ever served in the military, by the way. And a lot of the Iraq hawks, of course, were people who had never served in the military. Those kinds of people need to kind of learn to put on the brakes and have patience. And we, the American people, and people of faith especially, we know that the saga of faith, the truths of our faith, lives of faith, unfolds over a long period of time. It's not just snapping your fingers and everything is instantly okay. It's when we are patient and hang in there through the tough times as well as through the good times that then we get the insight that God wants to give us. All right. Hallelujah.
And
both learning from people on the ground in other countries and engaging with people at a global level who are thinking about what makes for peace and how do we promote those activities. Peace Corps is a really interesting example, but how do we promote the range of activities that actually promote a peaceful coexistence in the world? Like it's a hard thing in some ways to talk about the subject of our conversation today, which is militarism, weapon systems, gun violence, and so on. I think when we go in that direction, especially as people in the United States, it's such a huge topic. There is so much that needs to claim our attention just to try to pull into some, to pull back on U.S. militarism and U.S. exploits in the world and our own, the drivers of violence in our own society. But I do think that it is important to lift up examples like the Peace Corps, like U.S. Institute of Peace, as imperfect as they may be, and also to look at some of the big conversations that are taking place in the world right now. About 2 years ago, the United Nations, again, flawed as it is, the United Nations had engaged an external review of their whole peace operations system. Peacekeepers, the responsibility to protect, the peace building, their whole operation. In the course of that, or the result of that study, was that it was clear that we were approaching the work for peace in a way that was very short-sighted and much too limited in terms of time frame, so that what we had to do was to start thinking about sustaining peace, about building peace, beginning in places where the danger of breaking into extreme violence was not so obvious. The United States is a good example. We have tended to think in the past that we need to worry about peace in Iraq and peace in Colombia and peace in South Sudan. The reality is that in every country, if we don't safeguard those dimensions of our governance and our value system and our way of functioning together very carefully in any society, we can disintegrate into terrible violence. So the UN is recognizing that. The World Bank and the International and the United Nations together are finishing an important study called Pathways to Peace, in which they too are recognizing that the work for peace is not, it is about stopping militarism, stopping the arms race, stopping the profit in violence. But it is also about building societies, building cultures of peace, building relationships close to home and on the other side of the world that give us the opportunity to build the kind of world that we believe in. And I think it's really important for us, as people of faith and beyond, to hold on to the positive directions in which we know we have to move and advocate to move in that direction rather than always getting trapped in what we also have to do, which is pushing back on the engines of violence. So I think that's a wonderful example, the Peace Corps. And there are others that we need to lift up.
I love the Peace Corps, and I'm not even bitter that they denied my application to join the Peace Corps. Oddly, they didn't think that my experience as a theater major would be beneficial. I'm not bitter.
We believe you.
But you sort of touched on this, and in the spirit of thinking globally and acting locally, you know, the Peace Corps is invited in to provide support and whatever help is needed to the groups and the people who have been on the ground doing this work for years. People have been involved with gun violence prevention longer than I have. Much longer than I have. And you know, it's not my job to recreate the wheel. We do research, we come up with some ideas, but our local group, like, we support groups who have been doing this probably as long as I've been alive. You know, like I said, we don't need to recreate the wheel. We want to provide support to the people who have been doing this. Like I mentioned, Cure for Camden is wonderful. Mothers in Charge is a really great organization and service for mothers whose children have been taken from gun violence. So in the same way that the Peace Corps goes in to provide whatever support they can, I think we can do this locally as well. You know, if you're a theater major and don't get accepted into the Peace Corps, find what local groups are doing the work that interests you. See what your strengths bring to the table. That might help a lot of issues, you know? It might help that issue of people not being aware of gun violence until the white kids were being slaughtered, you know? Get involved with the communities who are doing the work now and offer what help you can.
Okay, thank you. Yes.
There is a national and maybe even an international organization for that. It has continued. It doesn't seem to be as prominent as it was. I think a lot of those programs actually started during the nuclear freeze era in the early 1980s, which was a great spin-off, I think, of that effort. I helped found the National Nuclear Weapons Freeze Campaign, so I'm glad if it had that spin-off effect. I know that we had a statewide conference for professors across New Jersey who were teaching in that area. And I think we had 50 or 60 professors come to Princeton University for it. Now that was some decades ago and I've lost some touch with it, but I will say, I mentioned earlier about the student chapters that have been emerging. It does seem to strike me that a lot of times those are emerging in places that have some kind of peace studies program as part of it. And by the way, I do see a connection also with Catholic institutions here, so I want to give a shout out to places like Notre Dame, which has a very powerful PROC Institute of Peace, but also St. Joseph's, Villanova. They both have good peace studies programs. So I think that there is something about Catholic values that has sort of penetrated those university systems so that they do a fair amount of teaching and programming on peace studies.
Just to add to that, yes, that's very true. In fact, I believe that it actually, in the last 15 years, there has been a tremendous burgeoning of various approaches to studying what makes a peace, and that it has been a very effective, rich development in that area. It certainly includes universities that have different variations. So Notre Dame is a good example, but there are many others. Eastern Mennonite University is there is a growing and very interesting alliance of peace-building institutions, including many universities. Two that come to the top of my head. One is the Alliance for Peacebuilding, which includes now hundreds of university programs and organizations focused on peacebuilding. And the other is the Catholic Peacebuilding Network, which is an alliance of the Catholic universities, mostly